Are Christians mentally ill? Well, according to modern day psychiatry, the answer would be yes, and in fact, in many different classifications. we're going to look about that today. I'm going to show you why psychiatry, what is the purpose of it, why it was created, and the problems that psychiatry has. Because psychiatry does have quite a few problems, this modern day teaching. And I'm going to show you that there are actually quite a few times in the Bible where people have certain things about them, characteristics, and modern day psychiatry has actually listed these now as mental disorders. And that's going to be the first part of the study. The second part of the study is, what does the Bible say about mental illness? Who does God classify as being mentally ill? So stay tuned for part two. First, we're going to start out here in our Bible today. In 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 20. Another one of the key scriptures that you ought to know. And you know, you need a King James Bible if you're going to be taking part in this study today. And if you are a atheist or something like that, you do well to just, broaden your horizons here a little bit, you know, open your mind a little, and actually see what the Bible says. And, do some studying outside of your narrow-minded, bigoted system of religion that you have there as an atheist. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 20 says, O Timothy, keep that which is committed to thy trust, avoiding profane and vain babblings and oppositions of science falsely so called. Okay, very interesting there how this verse is put together. Keep that which is committed to thy trust. Now, what was the thing that was committed to Timothy's trust? The Word of God. You say, well, the King James Version? Well, of course, they didn't have the King James Version back then. But the point is, the scriptures that they had back then at that time were committed to Timothy's trust. And he was to keep that. In other words, he was to hold to it, to stand by it, to not back down. Avoiding profane and vain babblings. And you're going to see a lot of this psychiatry stuff, a lot of their classifications for mental disorders are profane and they are vain babblings. And they are certainly oppositions of science, falsely so called. Definitely. Look at verse 21. Which some professing have erred concerning the faith, grace be with thee, amen. There are people actually that try to call themselves Christian psychiatrists. That is about one of the biggest oxymorons that there is. There is no such thing as Christian psychiatry, okay? And you say, well, then you're denying all aspects of psychiatry. Well, psychiatry couldn't be accepted by the general population if they didn't throw in some real science with it. And the real science that would be in psychiatry, there are real, true mental disorders out there. You say, like what? Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson's disease, Down syndrome, things like that. Yes, there are some things that are actual mental disorders. So they put that under the realm of psychiatry, under the realm of psychology and stuff like this. And they'll, philosophy kind of falls into this whole category as well. It's they kind of blend the three. But, the point is there are some things that are listed as, drug addictions, alcohol addictions, and things like this. Those are real problems that people have. But it's not because you didn't get a lollipop when you were a child or something, okay? Or you got picked on in elementary school. That's nonsense. All right. Or you were born this way. I was born as an addicted to alcohol, because my father was addicted to alcohol. So then therefore I was addicted to alcohol, genetically speaking or so. That's nonsense. Okay. Now I understand that you can pick up bad habits from your parents. I understand that, but it's more of a thing of rebellion. It's more of a thing of sin than it is some kind of a genetic trait. Now you have somebody that has Down syndrome. Yeah, there is a genetic problem there. That is somebody that the Bible calls feeble-minded. And you're going to see in the second part of this study what the Bible says, how we should take care of the feeble-minded. There are people that are feeble-minded, that have mental, real true mental disorders. So again, your King James Bible is not denying science. Your King James Bible is not saying that anybody that has some kind of a mental disorder is possessed with devils and they need some kind of exorcism or something. No. there are real mental disorders, and the Bible talks about it. We're going to see about that in the second part of the study. But I want to show you an article here. And you know, a lot of this stuff, I'm just going to have, I printed out these articles and things. I'm going to be showing them on the overhead camera. That way, I can do a Camtasia video as well, you know, actually record the screen of my computer. But if I put a lot of these links down there, I've noticed that, you know, a year or two later, the story has changed, the links no longer work, and all this stuff like that. So I'm just going to actually show it. I printed it right from the websites, and I'm going to show you the articles. But this is an interesting article here. We have medscape.com. You can see the address up there. The painful truth: physicians are not invincible. Now let me zoom in here a little bit. I'm going to show you that this is not some kind of King James only Bible thumper, you know, whatever, that wrote this. Mary N. Miller, MD, medical doctor there. K. Ramsey McGowan, PhD, Department of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences. James H. Quillen, College of Medicine, East Tennessee State University, Johnson City. So these are the people that are into the psychiatry field. Okay, these are not Bible believers. These are not some kind of, you know, radical Christians that are trying to make science look bad. Let me just show you down here what this article has to say. Rates of psychosocial problems among physicians. Look at this. Suicide. The overall physician suicide rate cited by most studies has been between 28 and 40 per 100,000, compared with the overall rate in the general population of 12.3 per 100,000. Overall, then, physicians are more than twice as likely as the general population to kill themselves. Each year, it would take the equivalent of 1 to 2 average-sized graduating classes of medical school to replace the number of physicians who kill themselves. This rate appears higher than among other professionals. Wait a second. Psychiatrists are there to tell the rest of us what's wrong with our minds. They're there to tell us that we're mentally sick. They would look at somebody like me, and I'm going to show you here in just a little bit. I qualify for all kinds of things, you know, that would make me mentally ill according to psychiatry. But they're going to tell me how to be mentally well while they're about ready to blow their brains out. Okay. And we're going to see, like I said, the second part of the study, we're going to look at the Bible. And you're going to see why the psychiatrists and these physicians and things are about ready to kill themselves. You're going to see why. There's a reason for it. Down here a little bit further on, it says, I have to zoom out a bit. They determined that suicide was the most common cause of death for young physicians, 26% of their deaths. Just get out of medical school. You're just starting to go into your practice there. Killing themselves while telling you how to be mentally well. Sure. Next page. Female physicians appear to be especially vulnerable. Suicide rates for women physicians are approximately 4 times that of women in the general population. The rates for male and female physicians are roughly equal, whereas women in the general population are much less likely than men to commit or to complete, excuse me, to complete suicide. In other words, there's attempts, but they don't complete it. But isn't that interesting? Female physicians are 4 times more likely than women in the general population to kill themselves. But they're going to tell you about mental illness. Down here it says, of the physicians who committed suicide, 42% had been seeing a mental health professional at the time of death. Okay, so, you know, the ones that did actually go through with suicide were actually going through treatment to prevent suicide. Doesn't look like that treatment is too successful. Next down here, we have depression. They found that 51% of female physicians and 32% of female PhDs they selected from the general community had a history of depression. Among physicians, psychiatrists, now look at this, had the highest rates with 73% reporting a history of depression compared with 46% of other female physicians. So So in other words, you go and you're a woman and you say, if you're crazy enough to actually go to one of these nuts, these head shrinkers, as they're called, and you go into this female psychiatrist and you say, doctor, I'm having problems. I have depression problems. Over 70% of them, what was it, 73 or 76? 73% report having a history of depression. So you're going to somebody who's depressed to tell them that you're depressed. And they're going to help you come out of it when they don't know how to get out of it themselves. From their own people, from psychiatrists. And you're going to pay them to tell you how to be mentally well? And this is a science, you know? Sure it is. How about divorce? Divorce rates among physicians have been reported to be 10% to 20% higher than those in the general population. Furthermore, those couples that include a physician who remained married reported marriages that are more unhappy. Boy, young people, if you could only go off to school and become a doctor, you'd be a success in this world. No, you'd be a failure. You might make a lot of money, but you'll end up being a failure, wanting to blow your brains out. And you're much more likely to have a divorce. Or if you stay married, you're going to have an unhappy marriage. And you want to be a doctor when you get bigger? When you get older? When you get out of high school or whatever? And go off to medical school and everything else? 26% chance you're going to blow your brains out? You might want to rethink that. You say, well, does the Bible have anything to say about that? Of course it does. You turn your Bible to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Throat's kind of acting up on me here today. I apologize for that. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 18 through 20. I'm not going to show these verses overhead here because, I mean, you can go online if you don't have a Bible. You can go to different, like Bible Gateway, I think, .com, BibleGateway.com. and there's, you know, you can get the King James Bible and you can look up these scriptures. So when I say look up such and such verse, you can go to some website, look it up in the King James, and read along as I'm reading it, just to make sure I'm not misquoting scripture, lying to you. You know, you got to do that. But I want people to actually look up the verses for themselves. I don't want to encourage laziness and I'll just put the scripture here and you can just, you know, read it. I want you to follow along in your own Bible. Okay. It says here, let no man deceive himself. If any man among you seemeth to be wise in this world, let him become a fool that he may be wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God. Now look at this. This is interesting. For it is written, he taketh the wise in their own craftiness. And again, the Lord knoweth the thoughts of the wise that they are vain. I find that very interesting. So these people, they come out and they say, we can tell you about your mental problems. And what's the Lord say? I want to take you in your own craftiness. Your own false science, opposition of science, falsely so called, that you've created, that man has created down there on the earth. The Lord says, because you're trying to come out and circumvent the Bible, how the Bible tells you that you can get well mentally, and we are going to talk about that, you know, in the second part of the study. The Bible tells you how that you can have mental clarity, how that you can, you know, fix your mind up. And modern day psychiatry says, no, we reject that. We've come up with our own system here to tell you how to be mentally well. And the Lord says, okay, according to those standards, I'm going to actually let you be mentally ill and actually be one of the ones that you're condemning with your own system. It's kind of funny how the Lord does that. Just give me 1 minute. I'll be right back. Got to get something to drink. All right, I'm back. It's kind of weird why my throat's giving out here. I don't have a cold or anything like it. But next I want to talk about this list of mental disorders here. It was on Wikipedia. And this is as of December of 2014. Again, I mean, you can look it up on Wikipedia, list of mental disorders, but I'm not going to give a link because it'll change and things like that. So, but they have 450 different definitions of mental disorders, according to the American Psychiatric Association, and they only list 198 here on the website. So, you know, we're not going to go through every single one of them, but it's kind of interesting because I went through and I looked, and out of the 198, I would qualify for 92 of these disorders. And, you know, it's funny because the more work I do for the Lord, the more, you know, the Lord uses me in ministry, and the more any of you are used in ministry, you're going to see that the list of mental disorders actually goes up, your list of mental disorders. And, you know, of course, I realize that some of these, you know, I don't really qualify for, like, as a perfect case for it. But if there was a psychiatrist out there that really wanted to examine me and make me look bad, and they kind of stretched some things, they could definitely qualify me for 92 of the ones I have listed here. And it's just interesting, some of these classifications I find kind of humorous, actually. So we're going to be going through some of this here. I'm not going to, like I said, I can't read all these. I'm just going to read the ones, the 92 that I'm, you know, that I qualify for. And, you know, again, you know, some of these, it's just more of a joke than anything. Because, you know, psychiatry, in my opinion, is a joke. It is an opposition of science, falsely so-called. I don't take this stuff seriously. You know, I mean, it's idiotic. It's a bunch of idiotic nonsense. They come up with these big titles, and you know, really, I believe that a lot of it's just personality traits. You know, you get somebody who's shy, somebody who's a little bit awkward socially, that's not a mental disorder, it's just your personality. But see, psychiatry makes it a mental disorder. You know, I mean, it, and you know, it's interesting, I did read another article on the whole thing of psychiatry, and it was by this psychologist guy, and he said, ironically, many could say that, you know, a psychiatrist actually is the one who's truly mentally ill, because they are the reason that they're looking for all this mental illness out there is because they have problems themselves in their brain, and they're actually trying to find the answers to their own problems by examining other people. So, and by the way, it's interesting, the father of modern day psychiatry would be Sigmund Freud. I like to call him Sick Mind Freud. He was a pervert, definitely. Hated God, hated the Bible, but Sigmund Freud actually died of suicide, assisted suicide. He had cancer really bad, and he had a doctor kill him, you know, in his old age. Interesting. And, you know, a lot of these other guys, Carl Jung and things, a lot of these guys had all kinds of problems, all kinds of mental problems. They were nuts. And it all stems back to one thing. I'm going to get ahead of myself a little bit here, but I do that a lot. But probably another mental disorder, you know, probably with the psychiatry thing. But the whole reason for modern day psychiatry is to get away from a little three-letter word in the Bible. You know what that is? S-I-N. Let's get rid of that nasty little word in the Bible, sin. Because sin can lead to and will lead to judgment. They don't like that. So they just say, well, you know, it's not really a sin. It's just a disorder. It's just this or that. And then they look at personality traits of Christians and people like that, and they say, well, that's a mental disorder as well. Let's look at a couple of these. First, you have, and I'm not going to show this list on the overhead camera here because, you know, there's some perverted stuff mixed in with this. And I know that there are children a lot of times that watch these sermons, so we don't need to go there. But you have abulia, A-B-O-U-L-I-A, disorder of diminished motivation. Okay, now they had big, you know, you can click on each one of these things and it'll take you to a separate article explaining it. And I just kind of gave a brief description without getting into all the big talk and everything else. Again, you know, tradesman terminology. You can't just say somebody that doesn't have motivation or something. No. You have to come up with some kind of a Latinized term to make it sound official, so that you have to go to some university somewhere to get a degree to learn the language of psychiatry so that you can come out and have a practice and people come pay you good money. You know, you see how that works. Bunch of nuts. But anyways, this abulia thing, disorder of diminished motivation. Well, that happens a lot with me. You know, there are many times I know I got to work on a study or I know I got to work on whatever, and it's just like, man, I just can't get motivated today. I mean, how many Christians go through that? You know that there are things that you should be doing. You know you should be witnessing. You know you should be praying. You know you should be reading the Bible. And it's just like, I just can't get motivated today. You know, you just feel like, man, I should just go back to bed and sleep and try it again tomorrow, you know. And again, you're going to see a lot of this. It's not a mental disorder. Okay, it's not some kind of a chemical thing that goes on up there. And of course, now we have the, you know, psychotropic drugs where you can pop a couple pills and, oh, you're feeling better now and I can go do the work and everything. Mm-hmm. How about adolescent antisocial behavior? Basically being mean to others as a child. And then it goes on to adult antisocial behavior. Well, if you witness for Jesus Christ, you will be considered as being mean by other people. Is that in a mental disorder? Of course not. An antisocial behavior. You know, I was very antisocial as a boy, a small boy, and I've never really come out of it. Why? It's just the way I am. It's my personality. I'm not a very outgoing person. You know, I will witness to people. I will talk to people. But for the most part, if you ever see me in public, I'm just kind of off in my own little world. You know, I always have been. I'm not a very outgoing person. You know, but that's a mental disorder. No, it isn't. How about agoraphobia? Being around too many people. Hi, how you doing? You know, yeah, me again. I don't like being around huge, large numbers of people. I mean, some people, they can walk through a busy city streets of New York or some other place like that, thousands of people walking around. I hate it. I can't stand it. I've been to rock and roll concerts and stuff back in my teenage years and things. And you know, I was like at an Aerosmith concert the one time, a Jackal concert, and some of these other big rock groups. And I was there, and it's like, you know, thousands upon thousands of people. And you're down there in like this sea of people, and they're just everywhere. And you're just like standing there like this, and there's people all around you. I mean, I didn't go into convulsive fits or anything, but I didn't like it, you know. But that's a mental disorder. No, it's just my personality. Then they have another one here. Antisocial personality disorder. Violation of others' rights. Okay. So by me preaching the word of God, I am violating other people's personal rights, you know, by telling them that they're sinners and that they're going to stand before an angry God someday and he's going to judge them. You know, if you reject Jesus Christ, you're going to be standing before an angry God. So I guess I'm hurting other people's feelings by saying that, so I have a mental disorder. And you're going to see as we go through this, again, I'm going to get a little bit ahead of myself here. I believe that psychiatry, I mean, we're talking only, you know, 100, 200 year old science here, came in around right around the time of evolution theory becoming very popular. You know, evolution, atheism, getting rid of God, getting rid of sin, getting rid of judgment. You know, and I believe that psychiatry was created specifically for the time of Jacob's trouble to determine who is mentally ill. And those people that are mentally ill, we have to treat them at special facilities. See, that's what's going to happen. That's what psychiatry is all about. And it's already happened in other countries and things too, by the way. You know, and I know it's happened to Christians here in America as well. You know, you get into psychiatric evaluation or something like that, and these smug, you know, insane doctors that are about ready to kill themselves according to their own people, they come out and they're like, you know, so tell us about yourself. And they got their little pad there. They're going to write down all your social disorders, your mental disorders that you have. But how about anxiety disorder? You know, basically fearing things. Well, you know, again, that could be put on a Christian. You say, you know, man, the mark of the beast is coming. Things are really getting bad. There's war. There's this. There's, you know, that. Oh, you have anxiety disorder. What else? You know, see? How about attention deficit disorder, lack of concentration, paying attention, etc.? Now, I mean, I went through public schooling, and fortunately, I came in right, you know, early 1980s mostly is when I was in public school. I graduated in 1994. It was a little country school, Pequot Valley High School. So there wasn't a whole lot of, you know, we didn't have very big, you know, student class or anything. It was just over 100 students in my graduating class. But, you know, I was in those years where you weren't being evaluated psychologically all the time and things like they do now to students, you know, in public school. And they weren't, I don't know of any kids that were on Ritalin or other antidepressants. You know, that was pretty much unheard of when I was young. But, you know, if you know, fast forward 10, 20 years, you know, if I'd have been a young boy in the 21st century, yeah, they probably would have medicated me. You know, there were a lot of times I wasn't paying attention too good and I was, you know, daydreaming and whatever else. They'd have probably said I was mentally sick. Sure, why not? How about avoidant personality disorder? Avoidance of social interaction. Again, you know, is this really a mental disorder or is this just the characteristics of somebody? Now, this next one I like here. How about a telephobia? A telephobia. Fear of not being good enough or imperfection. Kind of interesting. Turn in your Bible to Luke chapter 18. We're going to see this thing about a telephobia. Fancy words, you know. I'm sure that you're very impressed by the modern day psychiatrists. I know I sure was while I was doing the study. I don't think so. Luke chapter 18, verse 18 and 19, it says here, "And a certain ruler asked him, saying, Good master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said unto him, Why callest thou me good? None is good, save one, that is God." So it said there, fear of not being good enough or imperfection. So a psychiatrist, I guess, would have looked at Jesus and said, oh, you know, none is good. Oh, he's kind of psychotic or something. You know, he's standards. And of course, Jesus Christ is not saying that he himself was not good. It's just the guy comes to him and he says, good master. And Jesus is saying, okay, God is the one who's good. So are you calling me good because you believe I'm God? Or are you just be using the term good old so-and-so, you know, kind of as an expression there? Why are you calling me good master? Is what Jesus was trying to say. But again, see how modern day psychiatry would twist that and tweak that and make it look like Jesus is somehow mentally ill. God manifest in the flesh, you know, the creator of the universe. And, you know, you can see it many, many times throughout this whole study. We're going to see that their standards of mental disorders are actually attacks on people in the Bible. Not named, of course. You know, that would be another mental disorder to name somebody, I'm sure. Romans chapter 3. See, it wasn't just Jesus that was had this problem of a telephobia. See here that the Apostle Paul did as well. Romans chapter 3, verses 10 through 12 says here, "As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none that understandeth, there is none that seeketh after God. They are all gone out of the way, they are together become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good, no, not one." Now you get some puffed up, egotistical maniac called a psychiatrist. They don't like to hear stuff like that. You're a sinner. You're no good. You need to repent of those sins, because saying that, you know, you need to realize that you are a sinner and stuff and understand that your sins have condemned you to hell. You need to repent. You need to turn to God and get saved because you're worthless in and of yourself. Oh, boy, come on now. Oh, that hurts my ego and my intellect. And yeah, sure. Psychiatrists. See how the Bible condemns them? That's why they come up with this, all these little classifications of mental disorders. So, you know, I come along as a Bible-believing preacher, and I tell them, you're a sinner, you need to get saved, you know, you're no good and whatever else. And they go, oh, you have a telephobia. No, I understand the Bible. How about another one here? They call it Asperger syndrome. I've heard this one now, you know, that they say somebody that has a difficulty in social interaction, nonverbal communication, and restricted and repetitive behavior and interests. You know, I mean, you know, you get these people and they're different. They're more, they focus their mind better and things on certain issues, and they're not real sociable. They're socially awkward. Again, that's personality. That's not some kind of a mental disorder. You know, Asperger syndrome. Oh, you know, like Down syndrome, Asperger syndrome. You're like mentally retarded because you're not sociable and because you can focus on a task really well. Okay. And that's mental illness there, is it? How about the thing of bipolar disorder? And they have, you know, three different categories here. Bipolar disorder, bipolar 1, bipolar 2 disorder. You know, they say, you know, what is that? It's moody swings between depression and mania, and then it gets worse and worse and worse the higher up you go through the thing. So you have people that are moody that have two different natures. I thought that was kind of interesting too. If you go to Galatians chapter 5 in your Bible, Galatians chapter 5, verse 16 through 18, says here, this I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. But if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law. So as a Christian, you have two natures, two distinct natures that are at war with each other. Kind of almost sounds like you're bipolar, you know? And of course, you know, I realize that there are people that are, that, you know, really go into the, you know, mental, true mental illness or whatever from some kind of real bad accident or whatever kind of a physical thing. And they might actually have that kind of a deal there where, you know, they're really going to these bizarre mood swings, just snapping from one and going into another one, whatever, that are actually mentally ill. But again, if you get, you know, somebody and they're Christian and they're like, yeah, I struggle all the time between this thing in my flesh and the Spirit. And, you know, the Spirit wants me to do this, and yet my flesh goes the other way, you know. See, you get some psychiatrist, they could sit back and go, oh, it sounds like bipolar disorder, you know. I'll show you a good example of that. Turn in your Bible to Romans chapter 7. Somebody that's struggling going back and forth between these two different personalities, if you will. Romans chapter 7, verse 14. Read down through verse 19. It says, for we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin. For that which I do, I allow not. For what I would, that do I not. But what I hate, that do I. Well, psychiatrists would love that one, wouldn't they? If then I do that which I would not, I consent unto the law that it is good. Now then, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. Well, I bet Paul would be considered mentally ill by the modern-day psychiatrists. I'm sure he would be. Verse 18, for I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. For to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good I find not. For the good that I would, I do not, but the evil which I would not, that I do. You know, the psychiatrist right now would be writing furiously down with their little pencil and paper thing. You know, they'd be like, we got a sick one here. We got a crazy one here. You know, the Apostle Paul's nuts. No, the Apostle Paul was sane. He understood that your flesh, your body, is prone to sin. You say, well, then you get saved and it doesn't sin anymore. I don't think so. Paul was very much saved in that passage, and he's saying, my sin is constantly at war with my spirit. The Holy Spirit within me is constantly telling me to do things that go against my flesh. I can't tell you how many times I've sat down to do a study or a sermon, and it's just like my flesh is just fighting me the whole way through the thing. I'm getting tired, I'm getting, you know, back pain or whatever, headaches or whatever else. Voice giving out. You know, I can't tell you how many times my flesh fights me on that. You go out to a store and you know, the Spirit says, give that person a tract. Put a tract over there. Witness to that person there or whatever else. Flesh comes up with a million different excuses to not do it. There's a war there as a Christian. Interesting. Now, next one here. We have a good one. I like this one. This is one of my favorite ones here. We have one called, you ready? Bibliomania. That's a good one. I got to show you the article on this one. So I'll show you here on the overhead camera. Bibliomania. Here's your description. One of several unusual behaviors associated with books, bibliomania is characterized by the collecting of books which have no use to the collector nor any great intrinsic value to a genuine book collector. The purchase of multiple copies of the same book, an edition, and the accumulation of books beyond possible capacity of use or enjoyment are frequent symptoms of bibliomania. Bibliomania is not a psychological disorder recognized by the DSM-4, I guess there, or IV. I'm not sure exactly what that would be, what that designation means. Bibliomania. Collecting copies of the same book when you can't possibly use them all. I mean, you know, that'd be definitely kind of crazy. King James Bible. All five of those are King James Bibles. I mean, you know, there's some really sick people out there that collect multiple copies of the same book, and, you know, they just can't possibly use them all. I mean, you know, what kind of weirdos are there out there in this world that would collect multiple editions of the same book? And they just keep these editions around, you know, and, I mean, you know, there's some weird people out there. I mean, you know, who would need more than one copy of a book? I mean, you know, it's just like crazy to have so many copies of books that are the same. And you can't possibly read them all at the same time, and they're really not much value to the collector. You know, I mean, a lot of weird people out there, aren't there? I mean, you know, why would you want so many copies of one book? I mean, I just can't fathom why. I mean, you know, well, I guess I have bibliomania, you know. Praise the Lord, I have bibliomania. yeah, these are all the same book. Okay, they're all King James Bibles. And I can't possibly use them all. but I do give a lot of these away. And they're really of not much value to collectors, except for these two right here. Two of my oldest ones. This one's from, let me see. I can actually show this one here in a minute. 1828. I'll show this on the camera. Holy Bible. 1828. Right down there. This is my oldest King James Bible that I have. It's a neat little, kind of like a little pocket Bible. I had a brother send this to me. I really love this thing. Really neat one. Show you this one here too. This is a one from 1868. Another old King James Bible. Some writing there in the front. There you have the book of Genesis. Pretty neat. If you haven't seen the other video where I talk about my sword collection. But, you know, it's just funny, again, how they characterize mental illness by something that a lot of Christians do. You know, but again, you get some kind of a nut shrinker, you know, examining me and you know, trying to determine if I'm mentally ill. They'd look at all these copies of the King James Bible and be like, oh, you know, we got a sick one. You know, they got this weirdo here that's, why all the King James Bibles? Oh, you know, the King James Bible, of course, is against psychiatry. So, you know, that makes me crazy right there. And then to collect all these, and this isn't my whole collection, by the way. These are just the ones I felt like, you know, putting here beside me while I'm doing the study, you know. I mean, I got quite a few more. So if you're watching this thing and the rapture happens and you need to come to a place to get a Bible, you know, better come up here very quickly. Northeastern Maine. But I'll just leave those other ones there for now. But just funny. Bibliomania. Right. Sure. So little pieces of some of my older ones falling off there. So there you go, you know, and I'm sure a lot of you out there are just as nuts as I am when it comes to collecting Bibles. Let's continue. How about brief psychotic disorder, acting crazy because of an event? There's another one, you know. Well, I'm going to act pretty crazy when I know that the rapture is going to happen. If there's different theories on that, you know, that the dead in Christ are going to rise first, and we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet them in the clouds, you know. And we don't really know. I mean, you assume that it's going to be pretty much instantaneous. Dead in Christ, go up. Living, go up. But, you know, there's different people I've heard. They say it could be a few hours between the two. And you could know the Lord's going to come back. I'll guarantee you I'll act crazy if that happens. If the Lord says, okay, I'll be back in 2 hours or something, you know. And you know the rapture's going to be happening in 2 hours. Now, I can't prove that from Scripture, you know, I can't be dogmatic on that, but I would certainly qualify for a brief psychotic disorder, you know. Now we'll go on to the list of C, things that fall under the, you know, start with the letter C. Childhood antisocial behavior, already talked about that one, very similar to what the other one was there. Adolescent antisocial behavior. I had that one. How about cognitive disorder, learning and memory problems. Yeah, you know, sometimes I have memory problems and things. The Bible talks about much study being a weariness to the flesh. How about communication disorder? This is another one I thought was interesting. Communication disorder is a problem communicating with others. Turning your Bible to John chapter 8. Did anybody in the Bible have a problem communicating with other people? Let's look about that. John chapter 8. John 8 verse 43 through 47. Jesus Christ speaking here in the Bible. It says, "Why do ye not understand my speech, even because ye cannot hear my word?" Well, I guess Jesus had communication disorder. No, here's the reason why they couldn't understand him. Verse 44, "Ye are of your father the devil, and the lusts of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. And because I tell you the truth, ye believe me not. Which of you convinceth me of sin? And if I say the truth, why do ye not believe me? He that is of God heareth God's words, ye therefore hear them not, because ye are not of God." You know why atheists reject the book? Because the book condemns them. They don't like it. So they don't understand the speech. They don't understand the Bible. They look for contradictions and look for problems in it and things like that. Why? Because God's communication is dependent on one thing: you understanding your condition as a lost sinner. God will not reveal truth to you until you come to a point of being broken, until you come to a point of admitting your true state before a holy, righteous God that never sins. When you finally say, yes, I'm a sinner, yes, I'm worthy of hell, yes, I'm no good in and of myself, I'm just nothing. Okay, now God can start to talk to you. But until you come, you know, in other words, when you realize and admit that you are mentally sick in God's standards, according to His standards, then God will speak to you. But when you are prideful and puffed up and egotistical, God cannot communicate with you. Won't do it. Okay? You have to realize your true state before God before He'll communicate to you. That was the problem with the Pharisees back in Jesus' day. That's the problem with the modern day Pharisees, those people that hold anything above the Word of God. Pharisees held their traditions above Scripture. Atheists will hold their feelings and attitudes above Scripture. That's what's going on there. And by the way, it's more than just atheists. Okay, there are a lot of people that are mentally ill out there. Atheists are just one group you know, one aspect of them. We're going to see that in the second part of this study. Just thought that was kind of interesting. Next, we have conduct disorder. Childhood nonconformity is basically what that means. Well, again, I was a nonconformist as a child. I'm still a nonconformist. So I guess I'm mentally, you know, it's a mental disorder, according to these nuts. Next, you have Cotard delusion. And these are people that are, you know, victims that believe that they are dead. I'm going to show you an interesting thing here in Scripture. Colossians chapter 3. Colossians 3, verses 2 through 3, it says here, "Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God." So according to modern-day psychiatry, I guess somebody, a Christian that says, well, I'm actually dead, oh, you have Cotard delusion. You know. And of course, you know, you get the really, really sick people that are into this Cotard delusion thing. They're hanging out around graves and graveyards and stuff like this and want to be around dead corpses. And of course, you know, read your Bible. It's actually the man who's possessed with many devils, Legion, you know. That man is constantly in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones and all the other things. He's possessed with devils. So, you know, I think somebody that really, really, truly is hanging around graves and thinks themselves to be dead, they're probably just devil-possessed. You know, very good chance of that. But again, you see how a Christian that says, no, I'm dead. I've died to the world, to the flesh, to the devil. You know, I'm alive through Jesus Christ. And this world is not my home and whatever. You see how modern-day psychiatrists could take that and say, oh, you have Cotard delusion. Oh, you have a problem. You know, they have to make these little classifications for what the Bible teaches. You know, and they try to teach that we're mentally ill or something through that. Which is a bunch of nonsense. How about cyclothymia, mood swings? I've not met too many Bible believers that don't have some mood swings now and then. You know, we go through depression and things like that. You say, well, it's mental illness or something. No, it isn't. No, it isn't. It's realizing what's going on in the world. You're going to get down a little bit from that. How about depersonalization disorder? Feeling disconnected from reality. What did we just read? Set your affections on things above, not on things on the earth. You're disconnected from reality? Oh, and you qualify for mental disorder. No, you qualify for being mentally well if you realize that this world isn't it. How about depressive disorder? Depression. Of course, you're going to have that as a Christian. The Bible talks about, back in Isaiah chapter 53, that Jesus was despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. Paul talked about, I have continual sorrow in my heart. You know, doesn't mean that they were mentally ill. It meant that they were aware of reality. And again, you know, you get these psychiatrists, you know, the female psychiatrists, 73% of them have depression problems. They have the nerve to diagnose you as being depressive and stuff like this. Depressive disorder, excuse me. Derealization disorder. The world around you is unreal. Well, in terms of light, in light of eternity, yeah. You know, this is a real world. I mean, if I get hurt or something, I'll feel it. It's real. But, you know, in terms of your eternal destination, no, this world isn't it. How about desynchronosis? Desynchronosis. Wow. That sounds like something that's really, really interesting. And what's desynchronosis? Jet lag. So it's a mental disorder to have jet lag. You fly across a couple time zones and you get someplace and you're like, you know, I'm either really tired and it's too early to go to bed, or I'm very much awake and it's, you know, time to go to bed or something, you know. It's not a mental disorder. How about dissociative identity disorder or multiple personality disorder? You know, and it said at least two or more separate identities. As a Christian, you have a couple identities, you know, the old man, the new man, you know, the spirit, the flesh. And again, you know, I realize that there are some people that go through like the MK Ultra mind control programming and they come out with multiple personalities or dissociative identity disorder. So I know that there are people that are actually you know, genuinely mentally sick with that whole thing. I understand that. But again, you could get a psychiatrist and they could spin this thing a little bit, tweak it just a little, and they could put it on a Christian. How about Frigoli delusion? Believing that different people are the same person in disguise. Turn to 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. First Timothy 3:16 says, "And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up into glory." God was manifest in the flesh? Wait a second. You know, they say, well, how could Jesus be there and God is manifest in the flesh? You know, he is God, but he's Jesus. And he dies on the cross, but God doesn't die. Jesus dies, but God doesn't die. But they're one and the same. And how does this work and everything else? Well, that's what why the Bible says, great is the mystery of godliness. See, the mystery of godliness, God being manifest in the flesh, it is a great mystery to us. We can't understand it because we are mortal. We are on the earth right now. We don't really understand things in that eternal realm. So no, we can't understand some of that stuff. That's why to us it's a great mystery. It's like somebody who's been born blind. You can't explain colors to them. You get different colors of the rainbow, different colors of, you know, what's the difference between blue and red? Explain that to somebody that's never been able to see blue and red. You can't. You know, they can't fathom what that means. Well, we can't fathom everything about God, you know. But it's interesting that they say again, oh, it's Frigoli delusion. Because you see, you know, different people and you say, oh, it's the same person. Now, again, you know, I understand that there could be somebody out there that's, you know, possessed with devils or really crazy in the head or something. And they're like thinking that they see the same person, you know, out there. I see a whole bunch of different people and it's actually the same person in disguise, you know, not in reference to God. I understand that there could be somebody like that that would really be a little cuckoo up there. But you get a Christian and they say, I believe that God was manifest in the flesh as Jesus Christ. Could a psychiatrist take that and say, oh, you have Frigoli delusion? Of course they could. But let's continue. Ganser syndrome due to a mental disorder. Nonsensical or wrong answers to questions is what that means. Ganser syndrome. Nonsensical or wrong answers to questions. You know, again, could this be used to spin it and say a Christian that's not answering the right way at a heresy trial? Well, they have Ganser syndrome. They're mentally sick. Let's take them and torture them for a while, which is what the Catholics did, by the way, with people that were mentally ill. The Catholics tortured them. You know, we'll get that devil out of them or whatever else. They would torture people to help them be mentally well. Yeah, that was a good idea. How about generalized anxiety disorder, irrational worry? Have you ever worried as a Christian and it's not been rational? Well, that's a mental disorder. Congratulations. How about general adaptation syndrome, dealing with a stressful event? You know, and that's a mental disorder. Crazy. I like this one too, this next one. Grandiose delusions, also called delusions of grandeur. Ooh, you know, very big and exciting there. Belief that one is famous, omnipotent, wealthy, or otherwise very powerful. I'm going to show you the article here. Another little jab at Bible-believing Christians. Thought this was interesting. Grandiose delusions or delusions of grandeur are principally a subtype of delusional disorder that occurs in patients suffering from a wide range of mental illnesses. So, you know, wide range of mental illnesses there, though, as a Christian. Look at this. The delusions are generally fantastic and typically have a supernatural, science fictional, or religious theme. Down here to the symptoms. Exceptional relationship to a divinity or famous person. Okay, if you're out there and you're an atheistic psychiatrist type of person, let me just tell you about myself, okay? You want to hear about delusions of grandeur? God was manifest in the flesh. His name was the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus died on the cross, was buried, rose from the dead the third day. He ascended back up to heaven, and he gave the gospel to be spread out there. And anybody that believes in him will actually become part of his body, spiritually connected to God in heaven in the person of Jesus Christ. And guess what? You're looking at one of them. And there's a bunch of people that are going to post comments down there, and they're also part of his body. People from all over the world, and we're all part of the body of Christ, Christ being God manifest in the flesh, ruling and reigning in heaven right now. How's that for delusions of grandeur, according to your stupid little system? Hello? I like that one too. I thought that was kind of a fun one. How about hypomanic episode? Hypomanic episode. Highly energetic, talkative, and confident. Well, I get that way occasionally. I guess that makes me hypomanic. Next, we have impulse control disorder. Impulsivity, which can do harm. Well, I've done some things that were impulsive, you know. And, riding dirt bike and riding off-road and things like that, you'll have a tendency to do some things that are impulsive and that can and will, you know, do harm when you wreck. But continuing here, insomnia due to a general medical condition, in other words, problem sleeping. Well, when you work in ministry full-time and you're, you know, dealing with a lot of things spiritually and whatever else, and you don't even have to be in full-time ministry just as a Christian, you'll have problems sleeping sometimes, you know. Next, you have, intellectual disability, mental retardation or low IQ. Again, you get some psychiatrist that doesn't like the Bible, doesn't like, you know, they say, oh, the Bible's for simple-minded people. Well, then they could put that one on somebody like me. I'm not a university school or highly educated or whatever. I don't have a PhD or a THD or any of the other junk, you know. Just an old Bible-believing preacher is all I am, you know. Been through the school of hard knocks, been knocked down and put down and made fun of and whatever. And I've worked in factories. I've worked in restaurants. I've worked in the forests as a logger. I've, you know, done a lot of different things that have, and the Lord's taught me a lot through life. And I believe the Bible. That's why the Lord uses me. That's why the Lord uses a lot of you out there, because you believe what you read. You don't question the Bible. You don't have to feel that you are superior or of a higher intellect than the people who wrote the Bible. You know, people like us, me and my Bible-believing brothers and sisters out there, we don't feel a need to be the most intelligent people in the universe. Okay, we are very quick to put ourselves down and say, I'm less than nothing. You know, that's what we do. And we exalt the Word of God. We hold up our Bibles and we say, thus saith the Lord. I'm not smart enough to make a lot of these great, you know, classifications and distinctions and whatever else. But God is, and God wrote this book for us as English-speaking Christians. Let's continue. Intermittent explosive disorder, uncontrolled outbursts of anger. You know, again, they could put that on a street preacher. You get some psychiatrist, some nut job psychiatrist is about ready to blow their brains out, and they don't like to hear somebody condemning their sin. They could look at some street preacher and say, intermittent explosive disorder. You know, silly. Next, let's go on to the list of M, those disorders beginning with the letter M. Major depressive disorder, period, or very bad depression. Then you have major depressive episode, period of bad depression. So there you have two different types of depression, basically depression and depressive type events. Again, read about in the Bible. You will have depression. You will have times where you will feel very, very down. You'll see the way the world's going. You'll have family and friends turn on you, people that you thought, they're always going to be with me. They're my best friend. And they'll just whip and flip right around. And now they're your worst enemy. and it will lead to depression. There will be times you'll lose your job and you're not really going to understand what the Lord's doing through the whole thing. There's going to be times when you have to move, times when you have to whatever. You'll go through depression. That's reality. And again, you get these nut job psychiatrists, the female psychiatrists, 73% of them are in having depression problems. And they're 2 to 3 times more likely to kill themselves. Psychiatrists, physicians, 2 to 3 times more likely to commit suicide than the average person in the population. How about this one? Maladaptive daydreaming. Too much daydreaming. Again, how many of us are guilty of that one? Thinking about what it's going to be like in heaven, and you just kind of go off and you're thinking, boy. Well, that's a mental disorder? No, I don't think so. How about a manic episode? Prolonged psychosis requiring hospital help. Again, you could have that thing put on you. As a Christian, you're out there and you're, preaching the word of God or something like that, and they come and they say, oh, you're crazy and whatever, and they take you, haul you off to a hospital somewhere for psychiatric evaluation. They could put that on a Christian. Manic episode. I like this next one too. Mathematics disorder, difficulty learning arithmetic. Again, is that a mental disorder or just a personality? I had a hard time understanding and learning mathematics. I never even learned algebra. When I was in high school, I always skipped algebra. I'd take some other course or whatever else. By the time I was a freshman in high school, I realized that I was wasting my time there. I realized that it was just the same nonsense that I was learning over and over again. And I had multiple jobs in high school. I worked as a cabinet maker. I worked at various restaurants and things. And high school became a thing that was keeping me from full-time work. It was costing me money. I was losing money going to high school. And I went in for the guidance counselor thing, and they're like, what are you going to do when you get out of high school? I'm like, I'm going to do what I'm doing right now, but on a full-time scale. Oh, you aren't going to go to college? No. I want to make money. I don't want to lose money by going and sitting through more boring classes, And they tried to treat me like I was crazy or something back then. They weren't going to get through to me. I was just like, I want out of this stupid place. So, what did I do through high school? I took the very least difficult courses that I could just to coast my way through the thing. By the time I was in a senior in high school, I was taking as many study halls and things as I could. I'd go to the wood shop and I'd work on wood turning and things like that. Later became a professional wood turner out of, when I got out of high school. Worked for a couple years at different jobs and things. It's a big story. I'm going to put it together again. I have it as my old testimony, but I need to redo it. But another issue. How about melancholia? Inactivity resulting from depression. Kind of like the lack of motivation thing. How many people go through that? It's something you should go see your nut job psychiatrist. It's about ready to blow their brains out. You should go and let them tell you that you have that thing. It's crazy. How about a minor depressive disorder? Minor depression. Again, common stuff here, folks. Minor depressive episode. Misophonia. I like this one too. Hatred of sound. Well, how many of us go off to some store someplace and you're listening and they have the background music and it's playing like there's a grocery store in the area here, and I don't know why in the world a grocery store, they play classic rock from like the 1980s and 1990s, the stuff that I listened to when I was growing up, and before I was saved, and it's just like, yeah, I would really want to go through, looking for groceries, some whatever, carrots and celery and some hamburger, and I'm hearing AC/DC and all this other. So I guess if I would complain, then and a psychiatrist was nearby, they'd say, "Oh, misophonia." A bunch of nutcases. But let's continue here. Mixed episode, multiple emotions happening at the same time. Yeah. Mood disorder and mood episode. Being moody. Well, that never happens as a Christian. Sure. How about neglect of child? You're neglecting your child. You know, and I remember hearing the one time there was a, down in Pennsylvania there, down Lancaster County where I was from, there was a, some guys that came in to do a carpet job. And they said that this woman, you know, had gone off to work someplace. And she basically had a couple little toddlers, like 2-3-year-olds or whatever, that age bracket, 2 to 5-year-old children. And she said they just were like, didn't have any clothes on. They're walking around, going to the bathroom on the floor and going to the bathroom on themselves and things. And there's a dog and a cat and they're doing the same thing. The mother's off at work someplace. There's no father. You know, well, that's a neglect of child. Yeah. Is that a mental disorder? No, it's not a mental disorder. It's a lazy mother. It's a mother that you know, shouldn't be having children and things like this. She's not taking care of her children. You know, but that's not mental disorder. It's sin, again. But again, could a psychiatrist use this thing, neglect of child, and put it on a Christian? Say, oh, you're not vaccinating your child. Oh, you're neglecting your child. Oh, your child's not in public school? Oh, they're not getting a proper education. See, again, the psychiatry system can be used to persecute Christians, Bible believers. How about nighttime disorder, frequent nightmares? Again, you know, how many of us have that? Oh, it's a mental disorder. No, it isn't. It's spiritual attacks. Next, we have obsessive compulsive disorder. I had to print the article out on this one. I like this one, too. Obsessive compulsive disorder is an unhealthy obsession, according to this article here. Let me show you this article here. You have obsessive compulsive disorder. Zoom in here a little bit. Symptoms of the disorder include excessive washing or cleaning, repeated checking, extreme hoarding, preoccupation with different things here, religious thoughts, aversion to particular numbers. Huh. Aversion to particular numbers falls under obsessive compulsive disorder and preoccupation with religious thoughts. You see how the thing is set up? You go into the time of Jacob's trouble, these nutjob psychiatrists, they're left behind after the rapture happens. They're going to say, oh, you have preoccupation with religious thoughts and aversion to particular numbers. Oh, okay, you're one of those. You're mentally sick. We'll have to take you to a treatment facility where you can be treated to help you get better so that you can re-enter society as a productive member. Sure, sure. You know, the Bible says there's no peace to the wicked. That's the real case for these psychiatrists. They're mentally ill. But let's continue here. You have obsessive compulsive personality disorder, perfectionism. Yeah, Christians aren't, you know, guilty of that one at all. Onirophrenia, hallucinatory dreamlike state. Set your affections on things above, you know, in heaven. How about oppositional defiant disorder? Prolonged angry behavior. Like somebody coming out and preaching on the street and telling people that they're going to hell if they don't repent, that they're sinners. You know, sinners in the hands of an angry God. You know, I guess that was a wicked, horrible sermon there, you know, prolonged angry behavior. Sure. Orthorexia. Preoccupation to avoid unhealthy foods. Again, I'm not kidding you. Orthorexia. Look that one up. Orthorexia. Preoccupation to avoid unhealthy foods. So again, you're going through the grocery store and you're like, high fructose corn syrup. This stuff has HFCS in it. It's corn syrup this and corn syrup that. Aspartame and MSG, monosodium glutamate, you know, all these toxins. Look at all this poison. You get some nutjob psychiatrist there. Oh, we got a sick one here, you know. Orthorexia. Oh, good case of orthorexia here. Let's take them to a treatment facility. Yeah. on to the list of ones that start with P. Paranoid personality disorder, paranoia, and mistrust of others. Again, you know, you get called that all the time as a Bible believer. Oh, you're paranoid. You're paranoid. You know, I say, I think this guy's a Jesuit. Oh, you're paranoid. You're paranoid. Well, you know, he's doing the things that the Jesuits are supposed to do, that they say that their, you know, their goals are the same, trying to bring people back to Catholicism and teaching Catholicism under the veil of being a Bible believer. But I'm paranoid for bringing that stuff out. Next one says here, the parasomnia, sleep disorders, weird dreams, sleepwalking, etc. Excuse me. You know, again, I've never done any sleepwalking. My uncle did. I'll tell you that story in a minute. It's kind of a funny story. But sleep disorders, weird dreams. Again, is this mental illness? Is this mental disorder? No, it's just, you know, there could be spiritual attacks. You could have eaten the wrong thing before you went to bed. I know a lot of times you eat peanut-related things, peanut butter or whatever, stuff like that. You get weird dreams, you know. I don't know what that's all about, but, you know, I've heard people say pizza or tacos or things like that, you know, give you weird dreams. You know, if you haven't seen my thing on dreams and near-death experiences, you know, I dreamed about one time going to buy some organic honey bunnies. You know, rabbits that produce organic honey, you know. Well, I guess that's a mental disorder, you know, whatever. But this little story about my uncle, when he was a boy, my grandparents were sleeping the one night, and they hear this noise, and they look, and my uncle, Uncle Don, he's dead now. He passed away a number of years ago, but when he was a boy, he comes walking into the room, comes over, and he's just totally asleep. I think my grandfather said, "Don, what are you doing?" You know, and he just totally asleep. Comes over to my grandparents' dresser. They're in the bedroom. Pulls the dresser open, one of the drawers, pulls it open, and urinates into the dresser drawer there. Gets done. You know, pulls his pajamas back up, closes the dresser drawer, walks back, gets in bed. The next morning, my grandparents, you know, they said they got, you know, he comes down for breakfast, and my grandfather's like, "Son, why did you do that last night?" And he was like, "What? Do what?" They said, "Why did you go to the bathroom in our dresser drawer there?" And he was like, "Huh?" You know, and here they found out, you know, he had this sleepwalking thing that he would do, and it only lasted for a little while, and then he stopped doing it, quit doing it. But, you know, people have that stuff. You know, again, it's not mental disorder. It's just, you know, a little phase that you go through or whatever. You know, see, personalities and things like this, and these nut job, nut shrinkers here coming out and, "Oh, it's disorders. Oh, we can prove that you have disorders and, you know, you should come in for treatment." Treatment, you know, 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 10. Get some money. But let's see, where are we at? Next we have partner relational problem, you know, problems with your marriage, sometimes arguments and things. I mean, who doesn't have that one? I mean, give me a break. Perfectionism, striving for perfection. Aren't we supposed to as Christians? Of course. Persecutory delusion, belief that you are being persecuted. Again, you know, I can point to being persecuted. I can point to people that have been attacking me personally and whatever else. I can point to people making threats on myself or my wife, you know, on our lives, you know, and see a psychiatrist would look at that and they go, "Oh, you have persecutory delusion." Sure. How about personality disorder, being odd or abnormal? You know, I remember this one time, the Today's New International Version, they had TNIV.com YouTube channel. Now they don't even have that anymore, at least I don't think so, because I can't tell because I got banned from their channel. But I was posting comments on their videos, you know, advertising the stupid Today's New International Version, the feminist gender-inclusive NIV that they came out with in 2001, and then the whole thing in 2005. Now they've redone the NIV, you know, whatever. But anyways, I remember that the head guy there at TNIV.com, the YouTube channel, he said to me, he said, "You need to seek professional help and you will be banned now from this channel." So, you know, I guess I was odd and abnormal. So, you know, I need to have professional help. Next, we have phobic disorder. Now, I'm going to show you an old article here from the newspaper where down near where I used to live. I'm going to have to definitely zoom out. Well, here, I'll show you. First of all, this is the August 29th, 2004 Sunday News Living section. Okay. And here you have, well, let me flip the whole thing open here for you. The battle against fear. Phobias can be paralyzing. Facing them and seeking treatment are keys to overcoming their power. Okay, so you should seek treatment for all these different things, including, how about that one? Get this naked guy here in a box. He's, oh, he's scared, you know. Homophobia. So you should seek treatment for being against sodomy. How's that one? See, O'Brien, psychiatry is just an established field within the medical profession, and it has nothing to do with persecuting Christians. Oh, sure it does. Sure it does. That's what the whole thing is about. They've been building this kooky bunch of nonsense for years and years and years so that it can one day be used to, you know, basically torture Christians. I guarantee you that that's where the thing's headed. You know, oh, you're against homosexuals, LGBT, you know, lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender. Oh, you're against that. Oh, well, you know, you should be locked up, that you're a hate criminal. You should have things done to you, you know. Sure. We gotta understand where you're coming from. Yes, we certainly do. Next, we have physical abuse, physically hitting someone else. You know, that's a form of mental disorder. And again, you say, do you hit people? No, the Bible says I'm not to be a striker, you know, not a brawler, things like that, you know, and I don't hit people. But again, can you see how this could be used eventually to persecute Christian parents that spank their children? Oh, you have a physical abuse problem. You know, and, you know, can you go too far with beating a child or something? Well, obviously. You know, if you've seen my study on the Jack Hiles thing, this John Combs or whatever the guy, his daughter Esther Combs, and he like just, I mean, they just, she had over like 400 scars on her body and things. You know, the guy wasn't saved, but the point is, you know, that was done as a, he was a Christian Baptist, you know, and all this stuff. But next, let's continue here. We have post-traumatic embitterment disorder, overly bitter people. Again, you know, am I bitter about some things? I'm bitter about Satan. I'll tell you about that. I'm bitter about what the Catholic Church did to Christians down through the centuries. Sure. And the Bible talks about back in the book of Revelation that God remembers what Mystery Babylon did to the saints and martyrs of Jesus. The real saints, by the way, those that are saved, not those that are canonized. But continuing here, we have pragmatic language disorder. Basically means being blunt and offensive in your speech. Well, there goes Jesus Christ. There goes the Apostle Paul. There goes most of the other men in the Bible. There goes every Bible-believing Christian out there. We all have pragmatic language disorder. We're all offensive with the way we talk. And, you know, I don't care how sweet of a person you are. I mean, you listen to Gail Ripplinger sometime. You know, she's just one of the sweetest women out there. And yet people get offended at what she's saying. You have to be blunt as a Christian sometimes. Now, you shouldn't overly offend people. You shouldn't be a jerk about certain things. Sure, you know, the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle unto all men, apt to teach, patient in meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves. 2 Timothy chapter 2. I understand that, but there are some things you just have to be salty, as the Bible says. Salt is irritating. It's offensive. Gets into an open wound, it's going to burn. And people, their sin is their open wound. And you put the salt of God's word in there, you say, you know, the Bible says, it gets in that wound, it burns, it irritates, they don't like it. So psychiatry comes along and says, oh, that's a mental illness. Sure it is. How about primaria hypersomnia? excessive daytime sleepiness. Well, you see a lot of times with me doing a study, I'm going, yawning and all this other stuff. And why? Well, for the next reason, primary insomnia, difficulty sleeping. There are times I have difficulty sleeping. Sometimes I work too many hours. I don't have enough sense to get to bed early, and I'm working too late into the night and things. And you know, I get on a subject, myself and my wife both, we both do this thing. You know, we'll get into a subject that's very interesting, and we're just like, I'm uncovering things. Lord, show me things. And it's just like, oh, this ties in with that, and that ties in with this. And we found this website that proves this. And we look up things in our books here in our collection, and we, oh, yeah, you know, and we're getting all this stuff. You don't want to go to bed. You don't want to quit. And so a lot of times we'll go way too far, you know, and I mean, we'll sometimes it'll go, you know, 10 or more hours between times that we eat just simply because we're just so engrossed in our work that we aren't even thinking about the other things, you know. So again, sometimes you'll get sleepy. Sometimes you'll have a hard time sleeping. It's not a mental disorder. How about a psychotic disorder? Loss of contact with reality. Again, you know, a psychiatrist could put that over on a Christian. They could say, oh, you have a psychotic, you know, disorder there. You have loss of contact with reality. You believe in heaven and God and angels and the devil and hell and all this other stuff. How about a reading disorder? Difficulty reading. How many times do we have difficulty reading the Bible? When we should. How about a recurrent brief depression, reoccurring depression? Again, you'll have some of that as a Christian. Relational disorder, family problems. Oh, there's no Christians that have issues with that, you know. All of us Christians, we just get along totally with our family members. We don't ever have family arguments or splits or anything. Of course not. Never, no. How about residual schizophrenia? Acting less crazy than before. Just residual, you know. Again, you know, that could be put over on a Christian. Next we have schizoaffective disorder, abnormal thought processes. They could put that on a Christian for sure. Schizoid personality disorder, solitude, secretiveness, etc. So I guess that's probably what I have. I know a lot of the brethren have been rough on me, you know. And you're moving out to the middle of nowhere. You're going to isolate yourself and everything else. Well, there are times that, yes, I like to isolate myself. Kind of like Jesus Christ going off into the wilderness for, you know, days and days and days, 40 days, you know, fasting in the wilderness, you know. I guess he had it too then, you know. How about schizophrenia? Abnormal social behavior and failure to recognize what is real. And, you know, are there people that are schizophrenia, you know, the schizophrenic or whatever? People that are really, really, you know, crazy and whatever else? Something's going wrong up here? Sure, I don't doubt that. I know that there are people out there that are like that. Absolutely. But again, psychiatry can be used to put this over onto Christians. You get a Christian that's just preaching the word and just like, you're going to die, you're going to go to hell, you better get saved, you better repent, you know. They can put that on you as a Christian. Sleep paralysis, inability to move after waking up from sleep. Again, I talked about that in my physical encounters with the spiritual realm video. You can look that up here on YouTube in my, you know, go to the list of my videos and type that into the search thing and it'll come up. There are times I've had attacks happen, spiritual attacks that have come while I'm sleeping, or I wake up from sleep in the middle of the night and I see some kind of weird thing in the room, whatever else, and you just like, you're so scared you get like paralyzed. That's not mental disorder, that's a spiritual attack. And I had a lot of people commenting on that video saying, yeah, I've been through the same thing. You know, but again, you tell that to a psychiatrist, some head shrinker out there, they're going to say, oh, you know, they're going to give you another little one, little check, sleep paralysis. Sleep terror disorder, having nightmares. Again, sure. How about schizophreniform disorder, acting strange for a short time? That wouldn't happen for a Christian, don't worry about that one. Schizotypal personality disorder. Need for social isolation. Never had that one or anything. Here's an article on it from Wikipedia. This one's pretty good too. I like this one. Let me zoom in here a little bit. Schizotypal personality disorder is a personality disorder characterized by a need for social isolation, anxiety in social situations, odd behavior and thinking, and often unconventional beliefs. Like those of a Bible-believing Christian, you know, you're only using one Bible, you know, and you have many copies of it, so you're guilty of bibliomania as well, you know. You know, see, they can put this over on you easily as a Christian. How about this? Peculiar speech mannerisms and odd modes of dress, like women dressing in modest apparel, are also diagnostic signs of this disorder. In some cases, people with STPD may react oddly in conversations, not respond or talk to themselves. They frequently misinterpret situations as being strange or having unusual meaning for them. Paranormal and superstitious beliefs are not uncommon. See how they can put this stuff right on you as a Christian? Just incredible. All right, just a couple more to do here, and then we'll be done with the first part of the study. We have seasonal affective disorder, depression based on season. Well, again, that doesn't make you mentally ill or mental disorder or something like that. I mean, you live in a place like Alaska, some areas, you'll get, you know, what, 5-6 hours of sunlight during the day. That'd depress you after a while. You know, I was talking to my neighbor here, and he said a lot of people have depression issues here in northeastern Maine because it stays, the skies are very overcast during the winter months, and it'll stay dark for, you know, I mean, it gets dark early and gets, you know, it stays dark, and we get a lot of snow here and everything. People have depression issues. It's not really a mental disorder. How about, I love this one. This one's great. Selective mutism. You know what that means? Being shy. This is a mental disorder, selective mutism. No, it's a personality trait. If you're shy, that doesn't make you mentally ill or some kind of mental disorder. Crazy. How about separation anxiety disorder, missing your family, home, etc.? Well, I miss my family, the body of Christ, and I miss my home in heaven. I'd like to go there. I'm looking forward to going there. I get kind of homesick once in a while, you know. Want to go to my real home. So I guess I have that too, you know. Severe mental retardation. Again, you know, I've heard that, you know, put on me. You know, people have attacked me and said, oh, you're severely mentally retarded, you know. You're retarded. You know, you get some psychiatrists, they come along and say, oh, you believe the Bible and you collect all these Bibles and, you are retarded. How about shared psychotic disorder? I like this one too. Symptoms of a delusional belief that are transmitted from one person to another. Like witnessing and leading somebody to the Lord. You know? Oh, that's funny. Then they have sleep disorder. Well, that's fairly obvious. I think a lot of us have that. Social anxiety disorder. Fear of social situations. Going out and witnessing. You know, Paul says about without were fightings, within were fears. Well, I guess he had social anxiety disorder because he witnessed and that was scary to witness and he got nervous about that and stuff. How about social phobia? Well, it's basically the same thing as a social anxiety disorder. Next one, somatization disorder, recurring pain, headaches due to stress. Well, I never got that one before. That one, no. I never have headaches as a result of stress. Sure. Somatoform disorder. Physical problems based on mental issues. You know, again, you know, yeah, stress can lead to that. Specific phobia, fear of some item, individual, or situation. See, again, they could put that on you. As a psychiatrist could put that on a Bible-believing Christian. I like this one, too. White coat hypertension. High blood pressure from going to the doctor is what that means. White coat hypertension. You know? Well, there's a reason for that. As a Bible-believing Christian, I have justification for white coat hypertension, and I do get that. Last time I went to a doctor, which was many years ago, I had high blood pressure when I went into the thing. They took my blood pressure and it was way up there. There's a reason for that. Mark chapter 5, verse 25 and 26. And a certain woman which had an issue of blood 12 years and had suffered many things of many physicians and had spent all that she had and was nothing bettered, but rather grew worse. I know the track record of the medical establishment, and I know that there have been things I've gone in for different treatments and whatever all through my life, and a lot of times I get worse. You know, I went in for an appendectomy years and years ago, shortly after I got out of high school, and I was like really, really, really sick, and went to the doctor, and he was just like, oh, it's a flu or a stomach virus. So I went back to work, you know, and I'm just like, I mean, I was, you know, really, really bad. And my boss saw me and he's like, you need to just go home. You know, you're not looking too good. So I drove home and I'm like driving along and like my appendix had burst and I didn't even know it. And it was like, you know, I mean, I was like almost passing out. I was in really bad shape. My parents took me to the back to the doctor. My father took me back to the doctor and the doctor was like, oops, I think I misdiagnosed your son. Actually, I think it's his appendix is about ready to burst or has burst. You better get him to the emergency room right away. So we drove to the emergency room and I went in and they were like, into surgery right away. I mean, there wasn't any kind of waiting or anything. It was like, I almost died. And I got into surgery, and if I'd have died, I'd gone to hell, by the way. I wasn't saved at that point in time. And but I get in there, and, you know, I go through the whole surgery thing, you know, and they cut me open down there, and right on the bottom part, you know, right about my belt area there, and off to the right. And I remember I woke up, and I was like, had this tubes going up my nose and all this other stuff. I didn't even know what happened, you know. I was like half delirious by the time they got me in there. And I went through the surgery, and they put me out, and then I wake up, and I'm in the hospital room. I'm going, what in the world? And the weirdest thing, I remember I was getting, you know, a little bit better, I looked down on my left thigh, right above my knee, on the left side, and there's a perfect rectangle shaved off of my leg. And I'm thinking, okay, the surgery was over here on my right side. Why do I have this area of my leg shaved on my left side? Down at my knee. And ever since that surgery, that area of my leg is numb. I can touch it and there's no feeling there. It just feels like I'm, you know, the leg, I can feel other areas of my leg. I can feel my finger poking into it, and if I pinch it or whatever else, I can feel pain. This area down here, I can pinch it and do whatever. I don't feel a thing. What did they do? I have no idea. To this day, I still don't know. That's why I avoid the medical establishment. I avoid them like a plague. I cut my thumb a couple years back. I was taking a fan apart and things, and I grabbed some wires, and I took my thumb down across to the steel housing of the fan there. Went right down in through, cut my tendon in half in the top of my thumb there, right into the bone with this cut. I mean, it was bad. It took 7 stitches to get the thing back together, and I just had them sew up the tendon, and I was like, they're like, you know, the main surgeon isn't here to reconnect the tendon, and so we'll just have to, you know, tie the ends off. Then you come back, and I was like, nope, don't do that. Just tie it off, and I'll be fine. They're like, well, it's going to be crooked and stuff, and you won't be able to have full movement. I don't care. Whatever, you know. I had no health insurance, so I'm just like, don't worry about it, you know. But again, you know, it's like they messed up on all kinds of things with it. They, you know, I forget what the one nurse, she was telling me, she said, you won't be able to touch your thumb to your fingers if I don't get the thing reconnected. Oh, yeah, that happened. She's like, you'll be wearing sweatpants the rest of your life. You won't be able to grab pants and zip them up and things like that. You won't be able to touch your finger like that. Kooky. And these aren't brand new nurses. These are experienced, you know, ones and doctors and things like this. You know, trying to use scare tactics to the medical establishment. So it's not a bit of wonder. I go into the thing and it's like, we got to take your blood pressure. And it's like way up high. Again, it's not mental disorder. It's called mental clarity. It's called understanding the situation. So, you know, what a bunch of nonsense. This whole psychiatry thing, it's all designed to overthrow the Bible, to come out and say that man is not a sinner. Man just has mental disorders. You know, that's what the whole thing is. And, you know, I kind of compiled a little list here. After going through and studying all this psychiatry stuff, all their disorders, the perfect person then would have to be, number one, they'd have to be socially accepted, a perfect sleeper, perfect marriage with no arguments, no bad habits, highly educated but not too proud, successful, not afraid of anything, they never worry, and they're never sad. So if you're all those things, then you are mentally well. Does anybody know anybody that can qualify for that? I don't. I've never met anybody that's all those things there. So what is modern day psychiatry? It's a circus without a tent. You know? It's a bunch of insane people, according to their own writings, people that are 2 to 3 times more likely to kill themselves. And they're going to tell you how to be mentally well. They're going to call us Christians, people like me, they're going to call me mentally ill, while they themselves are 2 to 3 times more likely to kill themselves. And I'm the sick one. All right, that's going to be it for the first part of this study. When we come back in the next part, we are going to talk about how the Bible identifies mental illness. Okay, that's it. See you next part.